start today with quite a few announcements, actually. So you may or may not have got an email yet. I know they're supposed to be sending one out today. Today, for this class anyway, so Thursday, is the last day of in-person instruction. They're moving everything virtual for the rest of the semester. So what I'm going to do is set up a Zoom link in Blackboard, and I'll meet at the same times as this class. So if you want to join, just click on the link. And what I'll be doing is I'll have a whiteboard with a webcam on it, and then a separate computer set up so I can see, or not necessarily see you, but at least answer your question. I'll be able to hear you. And then I'll be showing poems on the whiteboard much like I do here. So I'll do that on Friday. Click the link if you want to meet. Otherwise, I'll just be sitting there working on stuff and nobody joins. Okay, so I'm still going to try to do as close to a classroom setting as I can. And for the people who are virtual, you'll just get a recording of what I do that day, like you do now. So that's kind of a big announcement. If you haven't got an email yet, you'll be getting one with a little bit more detail later. But for the announcements for what's due upcoming, so this Sunday you have the Chapter 7 homework questions. We've already covered everything in Chapter 7 on the videos, lecture videos, and PowerPoint videos. So what I'm going to do today is just review all of Chapter 7, doing endothermic, exothermic, and applying the Chatelier principle that we talked about last lecture. So don't forget to do those questions and the discussion. Now on Wednesday of next week, you have something due. So that's a week from today, the 18th, and that's going to be the Chapter 8 homework questions. So on Friday, when I do that Zoom meet, because it's virtual Friday, it's starting at 7 a.m. Friday, they said. So I'll be doing a Zoom meet instead of in class. I'm going to start Chapter 8, since those homework problems are due on Wednesday instead of next Sunday. So we do have an exam coming up. So homework questions for Chapter 8 are due on Wednesday, a little different than normal. You know, we usually have stuff due Sunday, once in a while on Wednesday, so I just want to reiterate that. And then a week from Sunday, so next Sunday, is when our exam's going to be. So I will give you more information on that next week. We will have a review just like normal. And I already have all the review. I even have a video and stuff posted if you want to start reviewing now. So it's like a little week and a half away is the next exam. All right, questions on what to do?
So Wednesday is Chapter 8, right?
Yes.
And Sunday, Chapter 7.
Right, so all the stuff we've covered so far will be due Sunday. Friday, I'll start Chapter 8, and that's due Wednesday. So we'll have Friday and Monday to cover Chapter 8.
So this will be this week.
Yes. So Friday and Monday will be Chapter 8 stuff.
Okay,
Wednesday and Friday will be review for the exam. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So let's review Le Chatelier's principle. We did it last class period, so I kind of made two sort of guidelines to follow when you're trying to figure out which way the equilibrium is going to shift. Because remember, Le Chatelier's principle had to do with equilibrium reactions and disturbances in that reaction, which would cause the reaction to shift either towards reactants or towards products. So generalized rules for it. So if you have an increase in anything, whether it's concentration of one of the reactants or product, or whether it's temperature, or whether it's pressure, so an increase in anything, the equilibrium's gonna shift away, so the opposite direction, from the reactant or product that was increased. Okay, so if any of the products increase, it's going to shift the opposite direction away towards the reactants. It's trying to get rid of that excess. If any of the reactants increase, whether it's the concentration or the heat, temperature, it's going to shift away from what increased to get rid of the excess. So now with decreasing. So this is when you're taking something away. So whether you're decreasing concentration, or you're putting the reaction in an ice bath to decrease the temperature, or if you're decreasing the pressure, it doesn't matter. Any decrease of any of those variables, you're going to see the reaction shift towards what was taken away. Okay, Okay, so if I decrease the pressure in this one, what I'm doing is I'm taking away some of the gas, right? That's going down. So since I decreased it, reaction's going to shift towards what I decrease. Okay, so if I'm decreasing either product, it's going to go towards the products to make more of what I took. If I decrease the reactant, it's going to go towards the reactants to replace what I took. Okay, so we're going to apply this to this reaction, but first we're going to figure out whether this reaction is endothermic or exothermic. That'll help us figure out where the heat goes. Remember, depending on if it's endo or exo, the heat could go on the reactant side or it could go on the product side. And then once we figure out where the heat goes, we'll apply some of Le Chatelier's principles. We'll start increasing and decreasing different things and see what happens. Okay, so let's start with looking at this reaction. So how to tell if it's endothermic or exothermic? What we're going to refer to, since we don't have the heat in the reaction equation, is we're going to look at the enthalpy given to us. So for this reaction, they gave us a change in enthalpy of negative 16. The important thing for enthalpy is the charge. So if it's a negative, it's one, and if it's a positive, it's the other. So does anyone remember negative enthalpy? Does it mean endo or exo? It's that big chart that I made from last time. It's actually exo. Yep, it is exo. So if you see a negative enthalpy, it's exothermic. That's just the definition of it. So when we have an exothermic reaction, exothermic meaning that heat is produced, so now, if we wanted to add heat to this reaction equation, are we going to put the heat on the reactant side or on the product side? The reactant side? So if we put heat on the reactant side, that would mean that heat is being absorbed into the reaction to produce the products. Okay, so heat absorbed is endo. For exo, heat is produced. So that means if we're holding on to the reaction, we're going to feel it heat up. And we're going to feel it heat up because it's one of the products. So we don't want the heat over here for exo. We want it on the product side. Because heat's being released. Once the reaction happens, we're going to feel it heat up along with the products being made. So how do you figure out where heat goes? If heat's produced, exothermic, it's going to be on the product side. If you feel it cool down, positive delta H, heat's absorbed, it's going to be on the reactant side. And that chart that I made, I think it was last class period, at the beginning of class, I summarized the delta H, the Q values, where the heat would go depending upon whether it was an endothermic or exothermic reaction. So to figure all that out, you can review that chart. All right, so we have where heat goes. We have our products and then our reactant. So now what we're going to do is we're going to start changing stuff. We're going to start altering it. And I forgot something very important. This is a reversible reaction. We can only apply Le Chatelier's principle to reversible reactions, so the arrow goes both ways. This particular reaction, notice we have one reactant breaking apart into two products. So it's a decomposition reaction, just for review. So let's look now, so I'm going to erase this portion, at what would happen if we change some things. What do we want to change? I wrote some examples down here. So what would happen, for instance, if, let me just write it out so you can see, which way would equilibrium shift? And then I'll just write a couple different scenarios after. So A, the first scenario. Is, I could say one. Scenario one is, what if I increase the pressure? applying the top one if there was an increase. So what you do now is you look at, okay, I know I'm increasing something, so whatever is increased, it's going to go the opposite direction to get rid of the extra. So that your job now is to figure out what's going to increase because of that pressure increase. So remember, pressure only applies to what? Gases only. So you're looking at these abbreviations. This is a solid, so it's not going to change that. That's a liquid, not going to change that. It's only going to change the gas. And how is it going to change it? Well, if the pressure's increased, the gas is increased. Because when you increase the pressure, you're increasing the solubility of the gas. You're pushing that gas down into solution. So since this goes up, which way does equilibrium shift? To the left, yeah, to the reactants. We're trying to get rid of it, right? It goes the opposite direction when we increase something. So in this case, it's going to shift to the left, or you could say towards reactants. Both are correct. All right, let me look at another scenario here. Let's look at what if we removed C2H5. What is that, ethanol? We removed ethanol as it's formed. This one, so we're not getting confused. Multiple scenarios. So now the second scenario is saying we're taking this ethanol, this C2H5OH, and we're removing it as it's formed. So what removing it means is we're taking it away. So if we're taking it away, essentially is what we're doing is we're decreasing. We're decreasing, in this case, the concentration. So we're taking it away. So if we're decreasing it, it's going down. So where is the reaction going to shift? More of this, right? We're trying to form more of this. And this is a product, because it's on the product side. So it's going to shift the opposite direction as this first one, right? This time towards products, to the right. Because the second one says, if you look up here, if you decrease something, in this case one of the products, it's going to move towards what was decreased. And in this case, what was decreased was a product, so it's moving toward product. Because it wants to make up for what we took. Get back to normal, back to where it was at. So what if this reaction was put in an ice bath? So you have to use the words and figure out what's going to decrease or increase if I put it in an ice bath. So putting it in an ice bath, it's not going to affect the reactants or the products. Like, it's not going to affect solid, a liquid, or a gas. It's not going to change that. But what it will change is wherever the heat is. So heat is over here on the product side. Now, if I put it in an ice bath, is the heat going to increase or decrease? Decrease. It's going to go down. Okay, so now we're looking at the decrease scenario, in this case, temperature. So if the temperature is decreasing, what is the temperature? Is it a reactant or a product? Is it on the reactant side or the product side? So remember, the reactant side is this, the left side of the arrow.
Yes.
Reactant, and these are the products. So heat is one of the products. Technically, there's three, right? So if heat is a product, and heat, temperature, heat, same thing, is a product, it's decreasing, we already said, so the reaction is going to go toward the products. It's going to try to, we took away this, so it's going to go towards it to replace what it took. So this was kind of a review of a lot of what we covered all in chapter 7. We identified it as exothermic reaction because it had a negative delta H. Since it's exothermic, the heat goes on the product side because heat is being released. And then we shifted equilibrium by altering concentration, temperature, and pressure. Let's try another one similar to this. So I'm going to do a new reaction. Sometimes they ask you trick questions. One can be a possible trick question one if you're not being careful. So we have sodium hydroxide, NaOH this time, aqueous, I'm going to react it with a acid, and we're going to get out principle, it doesn't matter if it's balanced, so I'm going to skip that part. What matters is that it's in equilibrium. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to apply some shifts, some disturbances to this equilibrium, and we're going to apply the rules like we did for the last one to see which way it shifts. All of these. So let's start with, what do we want to change? Let's increase something. Scenario one, the concentration of sodium hydroxide. This one's very specific. It's even telling us which one is increasing. Acid-base reactions are usually exothermic, so let me add heat to the product side for when we do one like that. Okay, so find sodium hydroxide. It's over here on the reactant side, and we just said it's increasing, it's going up. So we're looking at the top rule. So where is the reaction going to shift? Away from the sodium hydroxide or towards it? Away. You want to get rid of the excess. Exactly. So it's going to go away to the right toward products. Increasing the temperature. So if I'm increasing temperature, what is that affecting out of all of these? The product, because the heat is in the product. So we just said increasing, so the heat is going to go up.
So our product.
What was that?
Towards the product.
You think it's going to go towards the product? So if the equilibrium shifts towards the product, it's going to make more heat. But what do we want to do? Do we want to make more heat?
Okay.
Go to the right, right? So whenever we're increasing something, remember, it's going the opposite direction of what we increase. So we want to go the other direction, away from it. So this time it is to the left toward the reactant. Scenario three. This time we're removing water as it's formed. So we find water. Is water a reactant or a product?
Product.
Product. And we said removing it. So is it increasing or decreasing?
Increasing.
Decreasing. It's going down. So we're applying the second rule, decreasing. So if something's decreased, we move towards what was decreased. So are we moving toward the products, towards the water, or away from? So I'm taking this away,
yes.
And I want to replace it. So I'm going to move towards it to replace it, or away from it? Towards it, yes. So I'm going to go toward the products this time. Now for the tricky one. But we're on the board, I write this up here again. So the last scenario, we're decreasing pressure. And what does pressure affect? Gases. Do we have any gases? We have aqueous, which is a dissolved solution. We have a liquid, which is a liquid.
Yeah.
So do we have any gases?
No.
No. So decreasing the pressure, it's going to do nothing. Equilibrium will not shift. So on a question like this, you would just write no shift. Because I didn't disturb the equilibrium at all, because there's no gases to disturb. So that's why it's a tricky one. You have to look at the states and realize.
I'm glad you said that, because it's going to happen.
It's going to happen, yes, I know.
And
then you'd be like,
well,
I don't know, there's no gases, but does it change somehow? Yeah. So, try another one. Ooh, first, before I erase this, heat's on the product side, so is this endo or exothermic? You're right, yep, it's exo. Because heat's released, so that's why it's on the product side. You're gonna feel it warm up as the reaction happens. Yes. Okay. So.
I can't imagine that one as an exit. It's because endo is kind of confusing. Normally, you know, finish kind of thing.
Oh, yep.
If you, yeah.
I like the exo, exit. That kind of makes sense, because it's exiting out.
Yes.
That's like a mnemonic device, too. Endo's kind of hard, yeah. Entering?
It's like, it's like it has an. Yeah.
There's a lot of gases in this guy.
That's what I have to think a little bit. Oh, God.
Well, it gets easier as you
practice
it. It's just initially trying to get it in your head so it becomes second nature. This time we're going to do a little different. We're still going to be applying, you know, which way is it going? Is it going towards reactant or going towards product? But right, it's a different type of question that we're going to have to use to get there. So here's the type of question you might see. It's going to be predict whether the amount, in this case, of PCO3, so this guy here, will increase, decrease, or remain the same. So I'm going to give some scenarios, and using that scenario, we're going to figure out what happens to PCl3. And in order to figure that out, we need to know which way the reaction is shifting. So we're still applying the Chatelier's principle. So my first scenario is going to be if we add Cl2 gas. All right, so start it just like we did with the the other problems. Okay, ignoring this for now, look at what would happen if you added Cl2 gas. Which way would the reaction shift? Okay, so we're going to Cl2 gas. We said we're adding it, so that means it's increasing, it's going up. So if it's going up, which way does the reaction shift? Away from it to get rid of excess, or towards it?
Towards it
to make more? It's already making more though. So we're applying the increasing. So increasing concentration shifts the opposite direction. So we're gonna go this direction. Okay, so we're going toward product. But the question's not asking just what direction it's going, it's saying what's happening to this guy. So we're isolating him. So if this reaction goes this way, first of all, the reason it's going towards product is we're trying to get rid of some of that excess. So to get rid of it, we need it to react with the other reactant to make more products. So by the equilibrium shifting this way, this is going to go down, right? It's going to decrease. So what's going to happen to its partner? Is it going to decrease as well, or is it going to increase? So let's look at a picture diagram. Maybe that'll help. Let's go way back to chapter 3 and 4, where we're drawing pictures. So this is PCl3, Lewis structure anyway. And we're adding it to chlorine gas to make this guy here. I'm gonna draw the bad structure of it. Okay, so I have excess of this. I have a ton of it. And I'm trying to get rid of it. So to get rid of it, I need to make more of this compound as a whole. To make more of this, I need both of these to come together to make it. Right? So if I'm trying to decrease this, if I'm trying to get rid of this, I can't get rid of it unless it's reacting with the other reactant. So whatever happens to this chlorine gas, the same thing's going to happen to the other reactant. So if this is going down, this one has to go down. Okay. So if one reactant goes down, that means the other reactant goes down. If one reactant goes up, that means the other one goes up. Okay, they're going to follow each other. So whatever's on one side of the equation, the same thing's going to happen to both of them.
Because you're going to make less than the product, but it's not going to be, disturbed.
Right, exactly. So we're going to see if the reaction shifts this way, that means we're getting rid of some of this reactant, but in order to get rid of some of that reactant, we're also getting rid of the other, because we need both of them to make this product.
Yes.
So if the reactant shifts this way, PCl3 along with Cl2 both are going to go down. So the question is asking, will it increase, decrease, or remain the same? Since it's going that way towards product, we're going to be decreasing both reactants. So in this case, PCl3 specifically is decreasing. All right, so this is like using the Chatelier's principle and taking it a step further and seeing what's happening to the surroundings. So it gets a little bit more complicated. So let's try a few more. And try to solidify a little bit. So I have product. Is it increasing or decreasing? I guess it doesn't matter. Or I should say added, maybe not increasing. Added. Both work. I mean, it's the same thing. But basically what you're doing is you're going to find this particular compound in the reaction, and it's saying it's added, it's increased, so you put an up arrow by it. So let me erase this. And now what we're doing is we're increasing PCl5. It's a product. So remember, if we're increasing, the reaction's going to shift where?
Mm-hmm.
So this is increasing on the product side, so that makes the equilibrium shift the opposite direction towards the reactants. And like you just said, so the reactants are going to increase, both of them.
Yes.
But it's not asking about both of them, it's just asking about PCl3. So PCl3 is a reactant, so it's going to increase this time. So far we've just increased things. Now let's decrease something. So we're decreasing temperature in this case. So which one of these is affected by temperature? Heat. And we just said decreased, going down. So for decreasing, equilibrium shifts towards what was taken. So is it going to go toward the product or away? Toward the product. So if the equilibrium is going this way, what's happening to the reactants? Are they increasing or decreasing? Because remember, they're trying to come together to make more. You're right. Yeah, so the reactants in this case are decreasing. More specifically, the PCl3 reactant is decreasing. For these types of problems, your first step is to figure out which way the equilibrium is shifting using these rules. And then, if the equilibrium is shifting away from the compound you're looking at, that compound is decreasing. If the equilibrium is shifting towards the compound you're looking at, it's increasing, because it's shifting towards it means it's making more of it, right? So that's how you look at those types of problems. And I have some practice problems like this on the practice exam, which is already posted, if you want to look at that as well. So, questions? Yeah? Well, that's all the examples I have for today, I believe. So hopefully that kind of solidifies.